sister serves on the faculty of the Strang Cornell Cancer Prevention Center. She's published widely on the environmental causes of brain cancer.
Is brain cancer mortality increasing in industrial countries?
Without any question, it is.
Why?
We don't know why. I mean, that's the thing that we've been very concerned about. There are multiple factors we have to look at, but one of them may be, for some people, increased consumption of aspartame.
Better known by its brand names NutraSweet or Equal, aspartame is the most popular sugar substitute in the world. Since the FDA approved it back in 1981, it has become a multi-billion dollar industry. What most consumers don't know is that aspartame's approval was one of the most contested in FDA history. Consumers have reported more than 7,000 adverse reactions to the FDA, ranging from dizziness to headaches to seizures. But the makers say it is the most tested food additive ever and is safe for the tens of millions who use it worldwide. But Dr. John Olney, who has been studying aspartame's effects on the brain for more than 20 years, disagrees. He is a neuroscientist at Washington University School of Medicine. His new study analyzes U.S. brain cancer data in the years before and since aspartame's approval.
There's been a striking increase in the incidence of malignant brain tumors.
Dr. Olney does not say flat out that aspartame is responsible for the rise in brain tumors, but he does believe that his analysis of the data shows that it's the most likely suspect, because he says many researchers have discounted other environmental factors. And Olney says the same types of aggressive brain tumors that showed up in the aspartame animal studies over 20 years ago are now increasing in the American human population.
I'm saying that there's enough basis to suspect aspartame that it needs to be reassessed. FDA needs to reassess it, and this time around, FDA should do it right.
Aspartame was discovered in the mid-60s at G.D. Searle, the Chicago Drug Company.
I'm not the guardian of the White House or the guardian of the door to the president. People write about that and they speculate it. I suppose part of it's inertia from previous periods, but the president is a grown man. He's perfectly capable of working up his own schedule, and he does.
Donald Rumsfeld had worked at the White House when the president of Pepsi-Cola, Donald Kendall, had been the closest personal advisor, non-government advisor, to Richard Nixon. And they were buddies. And Kendall had been at the kitchen debate at the World's Fair when he debated Khrushchev and said, we have household goods and you guys don't, and so forth, and made a big name for himself. And Pepsi-Cola had been the company that had picked up Nixon as their lawyer when he lost for governor in California. And Kendall and Nixon were very, very close. And Rumsfeld got this tremendous boost from Kendall that pushed the product out into the food supply. There was a study done by the Centers for Disease Control in which 30% of the people who had complained about NutraSweet to the FDA, there were 650 complaints at that point, 30% of them had a reaction, gone off the NutraSweet, then gone back on the NutraSweet either accidentally or purposely and had the same reaction again. All of this was buried in the press. It was fascinating. The day that that particular report was issued by the FDA, Pepsi-Cola held a worldwide press conference announcing that they were going to add NutraSweet into their Pepsi, and completely swamped the news about these side effects having been observed by the CDC.
Hi. My name is Dr. Russell Blaylock, and I'm going to tell you about a commonly used sweetener. And what I'm going to tell you may upset you, it may shock you, but hopefully it's going to change your life for the better. The sweetener called aspartame, which I'm sure most of you've heard of, is now used in over 5,000 different food products, a number of medications, both prescription and over-the-counter, and a lot of beverages. But the deceit, the lies, and the flagrant abandonment of you and your family's safety is now legendary. And it's all a matter of public record. The If we look back in the history of the development of this product, it began at G.D. Searle Pharmaceutical Company, and it was discovered by one of their research scientists by the name of James Schlatter in 1965. At the time, he was working on an anti-ulcer drug, which was made of several component naturally occurring amino acids linked by what was known at the time as a powerful poison called methanol. As the story goes, he inadvertently had licked his fingers and he noticed that it was extremely sweet. He brought it to his supervisor, and the supervisor looked at this and said, well, maybe we can develop this further and use it as an artificial sweetener. Now, at the time, saccharin had lost its approval because of some questions about carcinogenicity. So the food industry was looking for a replacement sweetener at the time. Now, they discovered that this product was about 150 times sweeter than an equal amount of sugar. So over the next decade, the G.D. Searle Company scientists conducted over 11 experimental studies to prepare themselves for presentation to the FDA to get the product approved. And it was eventually approved in 1974 for use only in dry foods. But the approval then was quickly withdrawn. And that was based on an investigation that was a very extensive investigation done by Dr. Adrian Gross, who was the senior toxicologist for the FDA at the time. He studied not only the studies that had been done by the G.D. Searle Company, but he visited the laboratories and he interviewed the researchers themselves. So it was a very extensive and intensive review. Dr. Gross had analyzed these 11 studies, and it came under the title the Searle Task Force Report in 1975. Three of the studies he gave to Jerome Bressler, also an investigator for the FDA, and they found that there were major problems in these studies. In 1980, based on some concerns expressed by the neuroscientist Dr. John Olney, particularly concerning the high number of brain tumors found in the G.D. Searle study, and an attorney by the name of Jim Turner, they approached the FDA and asked for another hearing. The FDA agreed and held the Public Board of Inquiry hearing. But when we look at this, what we find is that they did not allow pertinent material to be entered into this Public Board of Inquiry that was discovered by Dr. Adrian Gross. In 1981, new director Arthur Hall Hayes was appointed commissioner of the FDA, and he approved the product over the objections of the neuroscientists and the pathologists who were on this public board of inquiry. And these neuroscientists and pathologists' main objection was the high number of brain tumors found in the animals exposed to aspartame. In 1983, Commissioner Hayes approved aspartame for use in beverages over their objections. 2 months later, after he initiated this approval, he left the FDA to accept a position as the senior medical advisor to Searle's PR firm called Burston Marsteller. Now, when it was approved in 1981 for dry products and again in 1983 for beverages, it was based on the idea that consumers would not be consuming more than 20 milligrams per kilogram per day of the aspartame. Now, shortly after this product hit the consumer market, it became obvious that people were consuming a much higher level of this than they had estimated, what is called the acceptable daily intake, or ADI. So what they did is they raised the ADI from this 20 milligrams per kilogram per day to 50 milligrams per kilogram per day, in other words, 2.5 times higher, a level that significantly increased the risk to children and especially small babies because of their small size. Now, today, studies have shown that people are consuming as much as 150 milligrams per kilogram or even higher.
Dr. Olney, do you think that aspartame should be on the market today?
No.
Why not?
Because it hasn't been demonstrated to be safe.